There's €1.50 I'm never getting back. I really don't know why I bother at times. Anyway, hello, welcome to Cycling Tips. I am Dave, and well, I think I've got a pretty good interview for you this week. An interview I recorded way back in September when Eurobike was on. Now, I've been waiting for the right time to put this out, and well, there's never a right time, so here we go. It is with an industry legend, a man who has changed the sport in many ways, both road and cycling, over his time within it. He gave me something like an hour of his time, more than I expected. Now, I haven't included the full hour in this video. I've just included the highlight stories, the really good ones. Some of them I'm hoping you won't have heard anywhere else. I know I haven't, and well, I'm a little bit of a fan of him and the stuff he makes. Who is it? Well, I'm guessing you know, because I've included his picture in the thumbnail, Tom Ritchey. So I won't waste any more of your time. I will throw you over to him, the legend, Mr. Tom Ritchey. I will warn you, the audio's a little bit shoddy in places, but Eurobike's a pretty hard place to get good audio with so many people milling about. Was your dad an inspiration to you for building bikes? Because it was his garage that you started out in, isn't it?
My father was an engineer, and in a community of engineers, and in a community of unique, outdoor, crazy engineers. He was a unhealthy smoker from the East Coast and moved in a very big fell swoop when I was 5 years old, turning six. Moved his family completely to the other side of the country, and the lights went off, and he became an athlete, a sports guy, and an environmentalist, and in a very quick period of time. And so all those things appealed to me, even as I was a kid, and I became somewhat of the same thing. He had an interest in making sure that I could do stuff in the garage, the family garage, with tools and have tools. And I quickly leapfrogged the family garage. Okay, so you probably don't know this about me. I built and raised an all steel electric car when I was 11 years old.
Sorry, 11?
Yeah. And so he would only allow me to cut the material, and he made me wait until he got home so that I could braise it. And finish it, of course, and make it, design it, made it. The electrical part he helped me with, but I have pictures of it if you want to see it.
Oh, hell yeah, yeah.
But as a two-passenger electric car, it's like the first generation electric car makers in Palo Alto.
You were Elon Musk before Elon Musk was Elon Musk.
It was 1969. I got a picture that the car's been in existence for at least a year or two. And rode it all around Palo Alto. The cops didn't
bust you.
Didn't bust me, no.
So I'm guessing you got top marks in woodwork and engineering at school then. Show and tell was quite interesting when you stood up.
Yeah, they kind of let me skip some of those classes.
What did you do instead then?
I was trying all the time to push the envelope. When I was on the national team and my business was going quite well, I was 10th grade turning into 11th grade, and I went to the principal at Palo Alto High School, and I said, look, I'm on the national team. I don't want to go to physical education. You've got to exempt me from that. I've got a company, and I'm making a lot of money in my company, and you got to exempt me.
15.
Well, it was 16, 15, 16. It was 10th grade going 11th. And so I went to the principal and I said, look, I want to only go to school and take the most essential college prep courses that are required. And I don't mind taking the hardest ones. And just work with me on credit for the rest of the day. So I want to come to school only for half the day. I want to leave at 11. I want to go to school from 8 to 11, basically, or 8 to 11:30. And I was it was too big of a thing to ask. So I went to the other school, and this principal said, yeah, I'll work with you. And and you can have credit. And if you work with the shop guy, tell him what you're doing, and the PE people tell him what you're doing. You know, all you have to do is just tell him what you're doing. You can leave school at 11:30 every day.
Please tell me they've at least named like the wood shop at school after you, or like even the school. Please, like, yeah, Tom Ritchey High School. Please tell me. Because of course you're also, you got the Hall of Fame for US mountain biking
and road.
Oh, yeah. You're obviously up there with some other big names.
Yeah, well, it's a small community, but you know, there were some very unique individuals at that time in the history of cycling.
It's amazing how a lot of the unique individuals, Gary Fisher, Joe Brees, you were all friends, weren't you? All.
Yeah, but I think in a general sense, you know, the USA Cycling Hall of Fame is the bigger pool of people, you know, that came from my time period. In that were Greg LeMond, Jacques Boyer, Mike Neal, you know, Bob Rowe, you know, all these people that were the first, Eric Heiden, of course, very good friends that had very successful racing careers, you know, went to the Olympics and started the whole pro side of the sport early on in the United States.
What is it about that generation and your generation?
Well, it was a scrappy cycling lifestyle. I mean, if you listen to the stories that Bob Rowe tell, and he's very good at telling stories.
Of course, he's a commentator now, yeah?
Yeah. So, I mean, if you just listen to how he did it, and you had friends that were similar, like Jacques, and how they did it, I mean, you basically had no help. You were making things happen. You were camping out rather than staying in hotels. You were like sleeping under bridges. You were like, you know, hear the story about Jacques after racing. I think he finished one of the classics, he was telling me, and he was 200 miles away from home. And the next day he had to ride back. He got back home and he was locked out, and he had to crawl through a window. And even anyway, it's just a whole different way that the world of cycling has progressed, that people just don't recognize it anymore, that we're just in the 80s living it. I mean, the tour buses and the way that they kind of, you know, protect the, I mean, that just wasn't there.
Do you miss that rough and ready sort of attitude with the sport then, that homegrown, yeah, sort of rough and ready? Because obviously you've still managed to keep that ethos alive. You still build your prototype frames in your garage, don't you, at home?
Yeah.
So yeah, do you miss that sort of...
You know, in a, you know, kind of a scary sense to people, I have the least, what I would say, good-looking bike of anyone in my company. You know, it is the most scrappy, usually unmaintained, ugly bike for, you know, development purposes. You know,
so like, is this because you're constantly changing it, tinkering with it,
or just wanting to be aware of the worst-case scenario that comes along? I break everything. I want to be the first to break everything. I want maintenance to be the worst, so that things that go wrong because someone out there is going to be like me.
So I'm guessing, you know, you don't partner with any cleaning product brands then?
There is no sponsor of cleaning products. I take better care of my car than I do my bike.
What car are you driving? An e-car? Tesla?
No, I actually love our Sprinter van with our camping kind of setup.
Oh, don't make me jealous. That upsets me. That's the dream vehicle for many cyclists.
Yeah, well, I started doing it. I converted one in 2006.
So you built it all out yourself?
Yeah.
Built your bike? Did you build a bike rack in there?
Have a garage.
Oh,
five-bike garage underneath everything. Yeah.
Underneath the bed? Holy
so
can we get some...
Martha has a really nice nice, like, you know, cabin area. And she doesn't deal with my mess and my grease and all that.
So you don't do hotels?
No.
You're still keeping it rough, ready?
Oh, yeah.
It's a wanderer.
Yeah, the wanderer.
Yeah?
Yeah, it's our number one home.
Got a few miles on the clock now, has it?
What?
It's got a few miles on the clock now, has it?
Yeah, it does. No, it's been over some amazing places, through some amazing places.
What places draw you to not just do road riding but mountain biking, gravel riding?
It's hard to be Europe in a sense, because you're stepping back in time. Everything is captured in the way things were built and preserved for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years. We don't have that. There's very few places that have that. It's wonderful to be here. It's wonderful to I can always find, it's not a matter of always, it's easy to find another exciting place to ride.
There we go, a few awesome stories from an awesome man. I hope you have enjoyed them. I'd like to say thank you to him, because he's such a nice bloke, so generous with his time. Let us know, actually, in the comments below, if you've ever had any run-ins with him. He's out on his bike all the time, so I'm sure some of you will have. Also, let us know what you'd like to see in future episodes of Shoddy, what you think of these videos in general. Be nice. While you're down that way, give us a subscribe, give us a like if you haven't already. And until next time, thank you for watching, and enjoy your riding.
I hope you enjoy this. It's the kind of interview I really like. There's a lot of people that do interviews that are dry, but I always find that being interviewed by the Brits and all gives me a great sense of enjoyment. Thank you.
Okay, the suitcase of money's just over there for saying that.